I did hear about Cormega on the street prior to me hearing about you as a rapper. I heard about you getting busy on the streets.
Yeah. Just because you're a thug or real nigga don't mean you could rap. Right, and just because you could rap don't mean you're a real nigga. I know niggas that's straight hood, but they suck. And I know niggas that's nice as hell on the mic, but they pussy. And I don't fit in none of those categories.
That's real.
Nigga looked like he was like 12 years old. He had a gun that was like motherfucking 12 feet. You know what I'm saying? He always kept some big shit on the hip, shit that he couldn't even hold.
Some wasn't having it, you know? Some was like, keep it red. He wasn't playing with niggas, you know? I had the Sterling, the guy that nobody ever seen, you know what I'm saying? The shit that...
Yeah, that nigga had the best gun and shit in the hood. We was coming up and shit. He had a hot gun, son.
Call him Sterling. Call him Baby Sterling. That's all. He know. They'll know.
Was a little
Sterling.
Nigga.
Goddamn machete on a rat. A nigga. Take that shit out of here.
Talking about Sterling.
Hell, no, that goddamn shit. I had on a ratchet.
Crazy.
Send him out of the room. I had mega.
My arms not married.
Well, you gotta get that shit out of here. I don't even know how you got that.
The illest gun in the fucking project.
Hell yeah.
Nobody could dispute that.
Yeah.
I'm saying, like me or you don't
man,
like me.
We were
nobody had a gun ill in the
we
street.
We were out of this
shit. That shit didn't go pop, 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 pop. That shit went
hell yeah.
Shit, burn your hands, yo.
I fucking that shit on the block one day. The police drove up, they looked at me, and they fucking busted U-turn and they left. Then they came back with like 7 cars and that.
At that time, Mega was like one of the most arrogantest dudes.
Explain that to me.
That's how you came up, Gross.
Okay.
Like, whenever I used to come around, I'll see you, I just be like... And later on, I identified with confidence.
Okay.
I was too young to look at that and say, that's confidence. I was looking like, you was always like a fly dude. You was always like flyer than the average person. Mm-hmm. So you came around, you always had the fly polo on. And always just... And I just would be like... And people, that was the rumor about you. Like, Mega's an arrogant guy. Have you ever heard that about yourself?
Arrogant?
Yeah, that you're arrogant.
Only from people that you hang with. Yo, when you think about this, nobody in Brooklyn says that. Mm-hmm. Nobody in Far Rockaway. You mm-hmm. know people from all over that know
yep.
me.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
If any, I mean, if that's the worst people could say about me, wow. If that's
beautiful.
The worst.
That's actually beautiful.
That's like,
yeah.
They said Jordan is arrogant. They said Kobe's
true.
Arrogant. I was confident, but at the same time, you say I wear polo all the time. There's a girl named TT from Queens, Virginia on the Hill. I got the crazy polo shirt, and it's dope as fuck. And she was complimenting me on the shirt. And it
one
was
main,
limited.
TT?
Yeah,
one main? Okay.
Yeah. And I'm saying it because she's alive. Shout out to TT.
Yes.
She'll confirm this. I took my polo shirt off my back and gave it to her.
Wow.
So why people don't tell that side of the story about Mega? Mega.
Wow. Come on, y'all. Come on. Wow. That's real.
And this is the history of...
What up, son? It's Mega.
Kids, it's going to be very philosophical and intelligent and shit like that. I already see it.
Yes.
Any man that truly understands the merits of peace will commend those who find it, unless it is something he himself has yet to find.
Mm.
Progression is fodder ground for those content with standing in regression.
Mm.
Peace is a beautiful thing. That's why it's noticeable when a person is at peace.
Mm-hmm.
They move different, and lack of peace leaves you vulnerable to turmoil, and that too is noticeable.
$1 billion ambition.
Oh, my goals as far as when I was in the streets was I didn't have any other goals but the street. I knew how to rap at the time, but I don't think I utilized my craft like I should have. Like, rapping was something I could do, but it was like a dream. Like, hustling was a reality. So I really didn't pursue any of my dreams or goals. The streets manipulated and seduced me. I wanted to be like the big dudes in the street. I wanted to have that respect, that status. You know, I was just trying to be that dude.
So you just thought, you just kept going, like you thought you were going to just be doing this for a career. This is it. You weren't gonna.
Yeah, exactly. I thought I was gonna sell drugs forever.
It's time to load up the autos and semis. I wish my niggas pink was in a physical form of life. I got my uptown Nikes ducked out and icy. Mad D jumping out the cocaine YG.
crew is struggling, so I resume hustling. Rap game, a crack game, my crew is still bubbling. Yo, 3 in the morning and the D's on the corner still. Seems we was born to kill your P, meet me on the hill. So we could jet through Queens through SUVs and show these motherfuckers how we rep this thing, you know?
Like you said, before I went to jail, I was buzzing.
I heard about Mega before I heard about Nas. Rhyming, to be honest.
And when there was a time when Marley Marl was like Dr. Dre of the East Coast.
Oh my God, I think I'm having a rap attack.
In control. In control. In control. Golden Era Radio.
Yes. You know what I'm saying? He just brought LL's career back.
Mm-hmm. That will be in the record.
Don't call it a comeback.
In the early 90s, he was working with TLC and this one and that one, big people, and he was busy, so like there was no artist in Queens that caught his attention.
Right.
So, and he heard everybody. Mm-hmm. So I was on the street still. Mm-hmm. And I think I told you before, there's a woman named Mary Stevens. Mm-hmm. From Queensbridge. Mm-hmm. And she got word to somebody, Hank Carter, who knew mm-hmm. Marley, and she was like, I want Marlon to hear his music because this guy is good, mm-hmm. you know.
You just called Marley Marl Marlon?
Marley.
Okay.
Yeah.
I like that.
So, Marley got wind of one of my joints. Mm-hmm. I had a song called Sex, Drugs, Bitches, and Money.
Sex, drugs, bitches, and money. Mm-hmm.
And Marley heard it, mm-hmm. and next thing you know, I got the call. Uh-huh. So me and LES was going to Marley Marl's house. Right. Recording, and the unfortunate
was Nas rhyming at that time.
Yeah, Nas rhyming.
Okay.
Nas. Actually,
this is history right now.
When Live at the Barbecue, Live at the Barbecue, and all that was out already.
Streets disciple, my raps are trifle.
Wow.
But I still was buzzing. Nas was doing this thing too, but I was buzzing. And the funny thing is.
Caught a case.
Yeah, I caught a case. But the funny thing is, even when I was planning my shit, I always, even as an artist, I always try to look out for people that was my people. Like, we went to Brooklyn Queens Day.
Mm-hmm. I remember Brooklyn Queens Day, Fussin Metal Park.
And we got on the stage.
You and Oz.
Yeah.
I feel like he
your
had
guy
a,
was performing.
I feel like he had a bucket hat on with Akinelli.
I don't remember.
Okay.
I know Traz was rhyming.
Okay.
And Yammy said, give Mega the mic.
Wow.
Yammy jumped on the stage.
Wow. And rest in peace, Yammy.
Yeah, and got the mic.
Wow.
And I jumped on the stage.
Right.
And I said, yo, where's Nas?
Wow.
Nas jumped on the stage. And I did my verse mm-hmm. from a song called Set It Off. Mm. That was on one of the Poets' albums.
That was on my album and shit. And he was like the first nigga on the album and shit, right? It's my album. And when Son came out and spit, it's like, that's my nigga, but he like overshined me and shit, you know what I'm saying? It's like, I was like, oh shit, this nigga is incredible,
true,
man.
True.
The dude was spitting some crazy fire shit, you know what I'm saying? So I had niggas like, yo, who the fuck is this Cormega dude? Mm.
And now I did his verse from Live at the Barbecue.
Wow.
So I wasn't even on, and I still was showing love. That's how we was, you know what I'm saying? So I opened up for Eric B. and Rakim at the Apollo.
Wow.
So all this stuff, Steve needed to chill, because he didn't do his research.
Right.
He didn't like me. He took things personal. Time out. Mm-hmm. This is why money doesn't make you happy, or money isn't everything. Because first of all, how long has Chris been dead?
Mm-hmm.
A minute, right? Mm-hmm. How long has these interactions happened? Me signing with Vale was 1996. Mm. So, you mean in 2018, no, when was that interview, 2017?
2017, 2018, 2017.
How many years later, like this, you're a millionaire right now.
Yes.
You got a good life. Like, let all that shit go. I let go, yo, I don't have no beef with nobody no more. I don't got beef with Steve.
Yeah.
I don't got no problem with Steve. I respect Steve. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. Whatever happened in the past, that's the past. Yo, people that live in the past don't have no real estate in the present.
I think we made some noise to that. Continue.
So
but you do know you're a legend. They're gonna have to talk about you. They gotta talk about you, Mega. I feel like sometimes you humble yourself and feel like people shouldn't, but that's you're a part of hip hop history. They're gonna bring you up every fucking time.
I'm gonna show you just how.
Okay. Oh, I don't know what this is, but I'm in.
Complex Magazine interview with Steve Stout. There was an interview with Cormega saying you. There was an interview where Cormega was saying that you had a role in him being kicked out the firm. Hey, Steve, he was never in the firm, man. He should have never been in the firm. Believe me, he wasn't. He and I truly didn't get along.
You coming with the
seats. Hold on. Time out. Even when Nas was shouting them out on One Love, they weren't cool. That was cool. He just got out of jail. It took him a while to get acclimated to what was going on. Time out. Let me fix this right now.
Yes.
First of all, One Love came out. Steve, you wasn't even in the picture. You was not Nas' manager till it was written. When One Love came out, I was in jail. I was there when Nas met you.
Whatever, Cormega, you still and y'all together? Yes.
Steve wasn't around. Okay. I was there when Nas met Steve. So right now, you're giving the impression that you was there. You wasn't.
He's on fire!
Even when Nas was shouting them out on One Love, they weren't cool. That was cool. He just got out of jail. No, I didn't get out of jail. I was in jail. That's why he said One Love. Mm. One Love is a term of endearment that people write in jail. Right. When I was writing Nas from jail, I would write One Love at the end of my letter. Okay? Now, shall I continue?
Yes.
That was cool. He just got out of jail. It took him a while to get acclimated to what was going on. In a business sense, he said in a business sense, and his manager at the time, a lot of different things.
And your manager at the time was Chris?
No, time out. He said, in a business sense, and his manager at the time,
Biz?
A lot of different things.
Biz?
Yes. Okay. Now listen to this. Okay. They didn't like Biz.
Okay.
Biz wasn't seasoned. He was new. But there goes Arrogant Mega again.
Right.
I gave somebody from the project a chance to be my manager.
Wow.
There goes me showing love.
Wow.
As usual. Wow. So Biz didn't have the business savvy of a Mark Pitts or a Steve or a Chris. Yeah. But he was somebody from the hood that I was trying to give a chance to.
Mm.
All right? So in the business sense, I own my masters and I own my publishing.
Right.
So how I didn't have a business sense? I've been owning my publishing since I was on Def Jams.
Wow.
Okay. A lot of different things. But here's this. He's actually a really good guy.
This is Steve Stout. Okay.
How the fuck are you belligerent and a really good guy? That's inconsistent. You can't be belligerent and be a really good guy.
This cross-examination is out of control.
I love this breakdown.
Time out. But he felt like Nas owed him too much and felt like he was too important. Yo, on my mother's grave, you could call Nas. You could ask Nas in your private life or anytime. I've never asked Nas for a penny. Nas not even the only famous dude from Queensbridge. I never asked Marley Marl for anything. I never asked Shan, Craig, Shantae, Craig, Nature, Capone, Nori, Mobb Deep, Louis DeVal, Ron Artest. Anybody from the bridge will tell you, even your man used to say that Mega don't ask nobody for shit.
Right, no.
So this is a guy who takes things too personal.
Right.
You can't mix business with personal. So when he wants to compete with Chris Lighty, that's the difference between Chris and Steve. Mm. Chris didn't let the personal intervene with the business.
Mm.
So when you saying I had to get acclimated to the street, I was just out of jail. Mm. You can't tell somebody that's fresh out of jail some of the things that you were saying to me as a man.
Mm-hmm.
Now, with all of this being said, I read this to show you the inconsistencies.
Right.
And so the next question was, so even when he was on affirmative action, he wasn't actually part of the firm? They asking him that. Because they're like, obviously shocked. And he's like, well, he was at the time. You just contradicted your very first statement.
Because you said he never was
exactly.
a part of the firm.
He said the ideal did surround him and he just bugged out.
Right.
Right? He said that project should have been fantastic. I have arguments all the time with Jay and Puff. You deflected from the question. So my thing is this. Where did I bug out at? Where did I bug out? Because I didn't sign to you?
Yeah, probably.
Because anything other than that, I didn't bug out. And same way I am now, I've been like that. It's just that a lot of people didn't know that. They had their perceptions. So the scariest thing about this whole conversation that we just having is that a lot of the narratives on me were created by other people, not even by my own actions. Mm-hmm. And that's the fucked up thing. And that's why I was like, fuck the industry, because it's like people was creating these things. I don't even like to party. It's like he wanted to be in the limelight.
Yo, the other day I got it on in my dorm. I had feline slippers on, then I transformed.